We are delighted to have with us Simon Glendinning, who is Professor of European Philosophy and Director of the Forum for European Philosophy at the London School of Economics. He has a BPhil and a DPhil in philosophy from Oxford University. His areas of specialization include the history of ideas, the philosophies of Europe, and European transcultural modernities. Apart from writing a number of articles in some of the most respected journals in the field, Professor Glendinning is the author of books such as On Being with Others, Heidegger, Derrida, Wittgenstein, 1998, The Idea of Continental Philosophy, 2006, In the Name of Phenomenology, 2007, and Derrida, A Very Short Introduction, 2011. Since 2007, the Wikipedia entry of Professor Glendinning tells us most of his work has involved a turn from European philosophy towards the philosophy of Europe, a critical distinction that I hope he will unpack for us in the next hour or so. Today, we welcome Professor Glendinning to Presidency University, where he will present on the topic Beyond Eurocentrism and Anti-Eurocentrism. Professor Glendinning.
Good morning, everybody. I'm glad to see students here too, although being an academic doesn't mean that I'm not nervous about this in-between space. And thank you, Amit, for putting it together so beautifully, and Shelley Spurr for actually making it possible. I'll say a little bit about what I think Amit has done organising this, when I introduce him, I think I am, later today. So I won't say more about that now. I've just finished writing a book, a two-volume book, in fact, on the discourse of Europe's modernity. It's called Europe's Promise. And in it, I follow a thread of anxiety inside the elaboration of Europe's modern self-understanding. An anxiety that made its way through a long list of developments, beginning with Kant, but then going through Kant, Hegel, Nietzsche, Marx, Freud, Valery, Husserl, Heidegger, Isaiah Berlin, Fukuyama, through to Derrida in the 1990s. Now that is a lot of men. And mostly dead, white, European men. And it says a great deal about the unraveling of the idea of Europe's centrality to world history, that this kind of focus and interest is not only increasingly rare, but feels fundamentally at odds with the contemporary intellectual climate. For example, it was as long ago as 1989 that Stanford University in America, one of the most prestigious universities in the world, totally abandoned its previously compulsory first-year course in Western culture. And they replaced it with a course called Culture, Ideas, and Values, which had a far more diverse selection of texts, in terms anyway of gender and ethnicity, for their students to study. So the times have changed in the culture of universities, and not only in America. But that desire for change doesn't just like fall from a tree magically. Indeed, I think it belongs to and is a particularly powerful expression of the coming to an end of the line, of Europe's modern self-understanding, the idea of Europe's centrality to world history. It emerges in and is symptomatic of that ending. And in this brief talk, I want to explore further this trend of abandoning what was called Western Civ courses in America, and the culture wars still rumbling on everywhere over the place, if any, of Europe's heritage and its history in a university, and indeed in our world today. Writing in the mid-1990s with a kind of cautious even-handedness about the change to Stanford's undergraduate program and the growing trend of universities in America to make similar changes, the British historian Norman Davis noted that the old courses were being abandoned, and then he says, for their alleged Eurocentrism. Now, while the qualification alleged shows something of Davis's reservations about the complaint against the old courses, and I'll come back to that, he is not at all uncritical of what he calls the limited visions of Europe that they tended to offer. He has two main objections to these old courses, the second of which will clearly acknowledge the merits of the accusation that these courses were Eurocentric. The first objection, though, which reflects Davis's knowledge, his own personal interest in what was still typically framed as East Europe, is the tendency of historians to focus almost exclusively on a supposedly more significant West Europe. His second and more trenchant criticism is targeted at the pervasive tendency in such courses to present what he called idealized representations of Europe's past reality. So this is a quote from Norman Davis. The really vicious quality shared by almost all accounts of Western civilization lies in the fact that they present idealized and hence essentially false pictures of past reality. They extract everything that might be judged genial and impressive, and they filter out anything that might appear mundane or repulsive. It's bad enough that they attribute all the positive things to the West, that's West Europe, and denigrate the East, that's East Europe, not here. But they do not even give an honest account of the West. Such hagiography is no longer credible. Now, it's significant, I think, that the prejudices and exclusions running through the old Western Civ courses were ever thought credible. But given Davis's clear-eyed appreciation of what you might call a subject in denial, one might be even more puzzled why he regards the charge of Eurocentrism as only alleged. Is there really room for thinking that actually this whole subject was not guilty of that? Perhaps. One reason might be, one reason to think they might not be guilty might be that a number of the authors studied in it were writing well before Europe, the word Europe, became the commonly used name for the little promontory on the continent of Asia. So those texts, could hardly be accused of, in Davis's definition of Eurocentrism, regarding European civilization as superior and self-contained. Davis might want also to add that if the courses really were on that civilization and not on some other one, then sticking to the authors who have been most continuously influential in the formation of its culture is not Eurocentric anyway. It is, he suggests, nothing more than keeping to the subject. Keeping to the subject. It's a nicely ambiguous phrase, one which, without prejudice to Davis's point, I'll want to exploit. For rather unambiguously, if there is one subject that such courses, in fact, keep to, it is precisely the white, European, male subject. It is his little promontory. And keeping only to that, with the prejudices it sustains and the exclusions it practices, is for those looking to change the curriculum central to the problem, keeping only to that subject. Eurocentrism, as Davis defines finds it may not be everywhere or indeed anywhere affirmed in the selected text studied. But the anti-Eurocentric recoil is against the selection, the canon, and against the very idea of keeping to just that subject, and of wanting us, all of us, to regard it, him, as the subject worth keeping to the exclusion of every other subject identity. And this is why the challenge is so tremblingly painful and fraught. Those texts never were just selected as representative samples of Western or European culture. No, they were selected, surely, as ones whose reading was thought most deeply appropriate to the formation of the kind of refined subjectivity that we should strive for through a higher education. These are not mere samples, but examples, exemplary contributions to the development of, and even to the idea of, the very institution in which they were being preserved, and to the way culture that kind of institution belongs to. Universities have wanted to teach courses covering the likes of, and this was Stanford's old list in the Western Civ course, Virgil, Cicero, Tacitus, Dante, Luther, Aquinas, More, Galileo, Locke, and Mill. And they wanted to keep to that subject because the culture of this culture is the one that has been regarded by those who want to keep to the subject as normative for us. It ought to be handed down as ours, and to become, for any subject, yours. Keeping to this subject, for those who wanted to keep to it, its devotees, is not only one we would have to stick to if, as Davis rather weakly affirms it, we want to illustrate the roots of our own culture and values. It is the subject we should, let's say, we should keep to if we want that culture and those values to have a future. As Jean-Paul Sartre put it, to choose between this or that is at the same time to affirm the value of that which is chosen. For we are unable ever to choose the worse. What we choose is always the better, and nothing can be better for us unless we think it better for all. For anyone, then, who finds themselves in keeping to this subject, there is a terrible loss in its abandoning. Davis is, as I've indicated, keenly aware of the really vicious quality of the denial internal to so many Western Civ courses. It keeps only to what is thought impressive and filters out everything that might be felt repellent. However, Davis is not unequivocally supportive of the anti-Eurocentric recoil either, and has some sympathy for the defenders of the old subject. According to Davis, the great paradox, of course, the great paradox of the recoil is that the European values so relentlessly celebrated by the devotees of the old subject, values such as tolerance, freedom, cultural pluralism, which he finds, like as it were, rolling out of these texts that are selected for the Western Civ courses. These values, celebrated by the old subject, are now, he says, under attack from those who have benefited most from them. Now, I'm not sure Davis's paradox really captures what is at stake here. For a start, is there really anything so very paradoxical to a situation where, in a culture where tolerance, freedom of thought, cultural pluralism has made its way, as it indeed has in the culture of the universities of Europe, those who have been able to make their way in it prejudices and exclusions. Indeed, if despite its prejudices, those who have benefited from its virtues find a way to open the space to people who are not white, not European, not male, and who have typically not so benefited, then good, that's surely good. Well, I've referred to prejudices and exclusions that are fostered by courses that are in their normative selection, if not always in their factual content, Eurocentric. These are not academically abstract matters, and the prejudices match the exclusions. At the time of the challenge to them, there were simply no texts by people of colour, no texts by non-Europeans, and no texts by women on the Stanford course. And those who mounted the challenge were saying, this is not good enough. This is not who we want to be, neither inside nor outside the university. Keeping to this subject is the wrong choice, the worst choice. The subject of these courses could no longer be affirmed as the subject we want to or think anyone ought to keep to. What Davis calls this great paradox might be better and I think more fairly expressed as an irony. The texts of the Western literary and philosophical canon have been integral to the formation of the very culture that can now freely abandon them. But this is less a case of cutting off the branch on which one is sitting or biting off one's nose to spite one's face, and more a case of throwing away the ladder once one has reached a better vantage point. The subject one keeps to, if one keeps to the hegemonic canon, is exclusively a white European male. The irony is that the strong and committed desire to keep to that subject has itself opened up the space for an anti-Eurocentric recoil that is run through by an equally strong and committed desire not to keep to it. To a desire to overcome discrimination on the basis of anyone's skin colour, not white, their ethnicity, not European, or sexual characteristics, not male. And beyond that eponymous trio, other cases of discrimination too, on the basis, for example, of sexuality, of class, of religion, and species even, for example. And hence a desire to make what I call a radical break with that old subject. Today, we can no longer make sense of a culture that would privilege the writings of dead white European males only as ours. We want to challenge the prejudices and exclusions that are preserved and preserved so transparently when we keep to the subject of Western Civ. And so at Stanford, out went Virgil, Cicero, Tacitus, Dante, Luther, Aquinas, More, Galileo, Locke, and Mill. And in the new course, in comes Rigoberta Manchu, Franz Fanon, Joan Rulfo, Sandra Cisneros, and Zora Neale Hurston. Now, somebody might say there's a new subject here. Somebody might want to speak of keeping to the subject in the new courses too, but that's going to be misleading insofar as the new course is characterized precisely by its project of diversification. It's not devotion to another singular subject identity, but to a diversity of subject identities, each of which, by the way, no doubt, has its own security gates and guards. And in this respect, the scene is not symmetrical. But we should remember that the charge of Eurocentrism is more strongly and coherently aimed at the devotees of the old subject, rather than to the dead white European males whose work was selected and kept to. And at this level, there is not only symmetry, but an uncanny likeness between the devotees on each side. It's not a singular subject over against a subject called diversity, but what one might call two lovers of responsible diversity. The one feels his or her love for tolerance, freedom of thought, and cultural pluralism under attack, and the other feels his love or her love for the same thing finally expressed. These devotees, the selectors of what we're going to present to you in your universities, these devotees, are they even finally two? There are certainly two programs in view, but one might say is the anti-Eurocentric mirror of the other, and as such they belong together as two basic expressions of the same subject. The one more self-congratulatory and backslapping, the other more self-hating and self-accusing. Now the idea that there is an internal relationship between these two programs is powerfully affirmed in the work of a philosopher who's been extremely influential for me, the Algerian-born Jewish heritage thinker, Jacques Derrida. Now, he's often positioned firmly on one side of this debate, on the anti-Eurocentric side. But his work expressly aims to understand and work beyond, he says, work beyond the logic of both Eurocentrism and anti-Eurocentrism. Derrida is well and widely known for identifying what in his earliest work he called an ethnocentrism within the tradition of Western metaphysics, what he thought of as the only metaphysics, the history of the only metaphysics, inside it, right inside it, instead of some kind of philosophical neutrality, a powerful ethnocentrism that he said as well is in the process of imposing itself on the whole world. But much less well known and more well recognized, however, is his identification in the same book in 1967, in a book called Of Grammatology. In the same book, and still within the history of the only metaphysics, of an anti-ethnocentrism. Discussing the anthropology of a contemporary of his, Claude Lévi-Strauss, for example, Derrida states this: one already suspects that the critique of ethnocentrism, a theme so dear to Lévi-Strauss, has most often the sole function of constituting the other, the non-European, as a model of original and natural goodness, of accusing and humiliating oneself, the European, of exhibiting it being an unacceptable in an anti-ethnocentric theory. Rousseau, who you may know Rousseau famously used the idea of the noble savage, Rousseau would have taught the modern anthropologist this humility of one who knows he is unacceptable. This remorse that produces anthropology. In later writings, Derrida would more often speak of Eurocentrism and anti-Eurocentrism. But it's the same basic idea. Eurocentrism and its anti-Eurocentric recoil constitute in their opposition what he calls one of the fundamental schemas of the metaphysical heritage that he sought in his work that he called deconstruction. The deconstruction of that metaphysical heritage and that fundamental schema in it of the Eurocentrism and anti-Eurocentrism, going beyond what he called the exhausting program of Eurocentrism and anti-Eurocentrism. In the case of the American culture war of and over Western Civ courses, Derrida's approach invites us to see the two programs then as two sides of the same spirit, the same modern European spiritual production of spirit. And it is a modern European spirit that is, on the one hand, he thinks, exhausted, finished. But on the other hand, it's a spirit too in denial. On the one historically dominant side, a spirit in denial that defines Europe only by its achievements. And on the other, until recently far less forceful, but now, as it were, completely ubiquitous in universities, opposing denial, which defines Europe only by its crimes. The laborious work of the deconstruction of this exhausted and exhausting modern European spirit or subject does not, however, set out to destroy or reject or abandon it. On the contrary, it wants to uncover within it another spirit, another subject, at once more realistic and more promising. At work, something in there, at work, within the work of that modern European spirit in denial, within it and going beyond it. And what is in view here is a central characteristic of the modern European spirit that Derrida highlighted in his engagement with the, what he called the spirits, plural, spirits of Marx and Marxism, in a book called Spectres of Marx. Speaking very cautiously of what he called a certain spirit, you might say a certain subject, a certain spirit of Marx and Marxism that he says he still wants to keep to, despite, he says, the totalitarian monstrosity marking its whole history. And Derrida emphasizes that spirit's essential readiness for self-critique. This is Derrida's perspective of Marx. To continue to take inspiration, that's inspirited, to take inspiration from a certain spirit of Marxism will be to keep faith with what has always made Marxism, in principle and first of all, a radical critique, namely a procedure ready to undertake its self-critique. This critique wants itself to be in principle and explicitly open to its own transformation, re-evaluation, self-interpretation, reassessment, if you could add. Such a critical wanting itself is necessarily rooted. It is engaged in a soil that is not yet critical, even if it's not yet pre-critical. This spirit is more than a style, even though it is also a style. It is the heir to a spirit of the Enlightenment which it cannot renounce. Derrida is especially concerned with roots in this passage. The word radical itself relates to the roots of something, just as much as it refers to the thought, to the idea of a thought which breaks with something. The anti-Eurocentric recoil might well be called, and certainly call itself, radical in relation to the old subject, and it does call itself that. But the radical spirit that Derrida says he is inspired by, sans filet, inspirited by, is not the one that wants to break with something else and go beyond that, but which wants itself to be able to break with itself, beyond itself, and to remain faithful to itself doing that. Indeed, to keep more and more faithful to itself in this break from itself. This radical critique is rooted in a tradition which that critique's own historical sense can and must never renounce, even as it breaks from, remaining faithful to itself by calling for self-critique, is to keep to a spirit or subject of critique which preceded it, and in the soil of which it is rooted, and which it wants to radicalize, that is to say, realize, for the first time, explicitly, as it were, as properly what is critique. Eric says, to critique, to call for interminable, never-ending self-critique. That's critique. That's what had not yet been attained by a spirit of critique that he calls the spirit of the Enlightenment hitherto, though it had in a certain way already promised that and was not simply opposed to that. Very nearly a month or so before he died in 2004, Derrida gave an interview to Le Monde in which he kind of knew he was dying and was trying to gather a certain thought together about what his thoughts had been about. And one of the things that came to the fore there was Europe, and this is a passage, a very important passage from that interview. Since the days of the Enlightenment, Europe has been in a permanent state of self-critique. And in this tradition of perfectibility, there is a hope for the future. At least I hope so. And this is what fuels my indignation before utterances that condemn Europe entirely, as if it were defined only by its crime. Hence, we should learn to see the possibility of a European memory that could include both the legacy of the Enlightenment and the legacy of culpability, of totalitarianism, Nazism, the Shoah, colonization, and decolonization. Attaining such a Europe forging itself in its own self-understanding, in this way, beyond the old programs. This, Derrida says, is a long historical labor. It's not going to happen tomorrow. But it is, he says, one that is underway. A long and slow development that promises to take it and us beyond, he says, beyond the old, tiresome, worn out and wearisome opposition between Eurocentrism and anti-Eurocentrism. And this, for me, remains Europe's promise. Thank you.